Good morning, church. It is fantastic to see you, fantastic to be here, fantastic that you're here. This is the best place we could all be on a Sunday morning is in the Lord's house together. And welcome if you're new here. You are welcome, not like Moana, welcome, but you are welcome like we are just glad that you're here. Know that you're in fantastic company as well. Because we are just a church chock full of sinners saved by God's amazing grace. Simple as that. Let's stand this morning. And let's pray. Father, as we gather here this morning, we just can't help but to be full of gratitude and thankfulness for everything you are, and everything that you have done for us, your children. I pray this morning, Lord, that as we gather here, if there is anybody here that does not yet know you and know the blessing and salvation that is freely offered to them, may they know that this morning. And may we who have been walking with you for some time now, may you reveal yourself to an even greater degree to us this very morning as well. We love you, we praise you, and we honor you with our day today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey guys, so I have the privilege of telling you about a couple things coming up here at Mountain Church. And the first one, kick it off, is Saturday nights. If you guys are regular Saturday nighters, listen up. We are integrating our Saturday night services into Sunday services, and that's going to be beginning in August. So August 4th will be the first one that we are all together here on Sunday morning. So can't wait for a new season, see what the Lord's going to do, having us all together on Sunday mornings. Again, that is starting August 4th, so make the adjustments on your calendar if necessary. Next up, we have Braving. This is for you ladies. It's going to be Wednesday, August 7th. And the focus this time, ladies, is going to be recognizing codependency. And we've had this class before, and we're going to continue these. And these classes are just giving you guys vital tools in helping women to develop healthy relationships. So get signed up for that and check that out. Also, ladies, you have some hikes coming up. And my notes simply say check out the dates and places online. They won't even tell me when and where they're meeting because I'm not a lady. So ladies, check out the dates and places online and get signed up. And with that, if you guys ever have any questions about the goings-on here at Mountain Church, go to mtnchurch.tv or check us out on Facebook. And as is customary for our Sunday morning meetings, we're going to take a two-minute, I call it speed meeting time, and because we do recommend highly to have relationship within the church, and so we're going to take 2 minutes to do speed meeting, and so say hi to somebody you don't know yet. Ready, set, go.
Morning, church fam. Let's stand together. Sing, Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
Sing, Lord, I come.
Lord, I come. I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Sing where you are.
And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. My songs arise to you. When temptation comes by, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Sing, teach my song.
So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power
in my heart.
I want to see you.
Lord, we thank you that you are in the house this morning. As we rally together as your people, Lord, we know that you are here, you are present. And Lord, we desire, Lord, just to have our eyes fixed on you, the author and the finisher of our faith. And so we welcome the work that you want to do in our life this morning. By the power of your Holy Spirit, we pray that you would just move through this temple and cleanse us, remind us of your amazing grace, that you would move through the temple of our own hearts, Lord, that we would be changed and conformed further into the image of Christ, which looks like love. And so we trust, Lord, that the work that you desire to do in us today will be accomplished as we worship, as we choose, Lord, to put ourselves in a posture to hear and respond. For those of us, Lord, that have been around the Word and been around your people and been in your presence for many years now, we pray, Lord, that our hearts would not be hardened, that we would never be in a position of, well, I've heard that or I've read that before, but we would be reminded that, Lord, your word is living and you desire to speak to us and shape us. For those that don't know you, Lord, we pray that you would reveal yourself to us this morning and, Lord, that we would know the love of God and that we would know your amazing grace and that we would know the free gift of salvation. And so we just desire to worship. It's what we were created to do. Everything was created for you and by you and for your pleasure. And so we desire to please you, Lord, as we sing songs of praise, as we open and read your word and respond to it, as we come and have communion today, as we give, as we pray. All that we do, Lord, we want to do it to bring honor to you as an act of worship. So you be blessed, you be honored, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Everybody said? Amen. Amen. Right on. You guys can have a seat. And once again, it's great to see you guys this morning. We were, a lot of us were over on the coast last week at Mountain Camp. If you ever get a chance to come over to Mountain Camp with us on our summer camps, man, we have a great time. And what happens at camp stays at camp. So we had just a great, great week. So, but good to be back. And if you're new here, we welcome you. Glad you guys are here this morning. And we're just rolling through the Word of God. That's what we do here. We teach through God's Word. And so we're presently in 1 John chapter 2. So you can open up your Bibles to 1 John chapter 2, or you can open up your Bible apps on any of your devices to 1 John chapter 2. Or if you have neither of those, we will run a Bible down to you right now if you want one to follow along with us this morning and to bring with you home and read. Just lift your hand if you need a Bible. We'll run one down. Guys are looking right now for any hands that are up. And if you need one, just lift your hand. So a couple of weeks ago, we looked at what the wise old apostle John had to say about loving one another. And John was a young man when he was first called by Jesus to drop his nets and to follow Jesus. He walked with Jesus on planet Earth, spent time around the campfire with him, saw Jesus doing a variety of miracles. He was there at the cross when Christ died on the cross. John was one that was just radically transformed by the power of the presence of God in his life and the power of the resurrection. He would go on after the ascension, after Jesus ascended to be with the Father, John would go on and continue the work of the ministry of the gospel. And so he planted churches and he encouraged the church, and now he's gotten older and he's kind of refined his message. And his message has really come down to this. Listen, love God and love each other. He's you know, in his old age, this old sage John has kind of boiled everything down to really what Jesus said. And that was, what is the greatest commandment? And he would say, love God and love each other. And that kind of became John's theme late in life. And he's writing now this letter out to the churches that have been scattered throughout Asia Minor due to persecution. There were some famines going on. There was a lot of dispersion of the church. And John's writing what would be his final letters. his final just words of encouragement to the church. And a couple of weeks ago, we looked at how the church family of believers are to take care of one another. And he would approach this as a father talking to his children. That's how John would approach this letter. And he would say, listen, family, love each other. It's really important. It's the mark of maturity to love one another. And he would say, I'm commanding you to do this. And it's not a new commandment. It's a commandment that's old. Matter of fact, God created in love from the very beginning. Everything that he's ever done is done in love. And so he's saying it's an old command. It's an old story. It's nothing new. And yet he would go on to say, but it is new. It's old and it's new. In other words, it's fresh. It's right now. It's not something that we do once way back in the day. It's something that we continue to do every day. We love each other and we serve one another and we provide for one another and we, you know, tend to one another, and he's exhorting us. And if you remember, we kind of broke that down into three main categories on what does it mean to love each other? And this was not an exhaustive list, but it was a list that I think was very, it was general in categorization. And that is, how do we love one another? First of all, we love one another by giving. Secondly, we love one another by serving. And thirdly, we love one another by dying. And it's those three elements that Jesus taught us how to love. Jesus was one that gave his life for us. He was a giver, the giver of life and giving up his own life. He was a servant. He came to be the servant of all. He took on the form of a slave, the form of a servant. He would take a knee and wrap himself in a servant's towel, and he would wash the dirty feet of the disciples. So he's demonstrating to us what love looks like: giving, serving, and ultimately dying. And those are three main categories or three major breakdowns of what love looks like. We implement these in our relationships, and we have healthy relationships. We implement these truths in our marriages, and we have healthy marriages: serving, giving, dying. And the disciple of Jesus, John, would say this is an imperative in the life of every believer, every disciple of Christ, that we should be marked by these things. When people get to know me and they get to know you in relationship, it should be said of you, wow, you know, as I've gotten to know that individual, man, he really loves. She is really a lover. She gives and serves and dies for others. She lives her life not self-centric, but she lives her life for others. And now John begins to follow up on that in the context of loving and the context of loving one another. He continues now and tells us what not to love. He says, this is important, that we love God and that we love each other. And in that same flow of context, now he says, but don't love this. And he throws up a big warning flag. Remember, he's an aged disciple of Jesus that walked with Jesus with great wisdom and great experience. Oh, that we would learn from the wisdom and the experience of the elderly. And John now says this in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. He says, do not love. After telling us the importance of love, he says, do not love this world, nor the things that it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything that we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from this world. And this world is fading away along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever. John uses this word world in this context in a negative sense. He would say, listen, disciple of Jesus, be careful that you aren't drawn in to love the world, meaning the world system. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life. He says, be careful that we don't get lured in to loving those things. We're to love God and to love one another, but all of us are going to be drawn in to love those other things. There's an attraction. There's a beauty. And he uses the word world, and he uses it in the context of the world system. That mold that the world is always trying to shape us into. You need this. You want that. This will make you happy. You got to have more of these things. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, that's what you need. And he's warning us, saying, don't fall in love with that. Now he uses the word world in another context in his gospel. In John, for instance, chapter 3, verse 16, where John would say, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Same word, but he uses it in the context, meaning God loves the world, not the world system, the world in humanity. He loves the world. And so we are to love the world in humanity, loving every man, every woman, every race, every tongue, every tribe, every nation. We are to love all of humanity, for all of us were created imago Dei. We were all created in the image of God. And so we're to love the world, but not love the world system, and not fall in love with the world's system. And so let's break that down. What does that world system look like? Well, broken down by John, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, in three things: lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and the pride of life. The lust of the flesh. A great definition of the lust of the flesh, I believe it's the gold standard definition, was given by the Apostle Paul in Galatians chapter 5. He says this: now the works of the flesh are manifest. I'm cross-referencing in the King James. Which are these? These are the works of the flesh. This is the lust of the flesh. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Paul would define this lust of the flesh in these things. And Paul said, you know, this is a list of what the lusts of the flesh look like, but it's not exclusive to this. Matter of fact, he puts in a little note right there in the middle. It says, and such like. In other words, this is not an exhaustive list. You can add to that list anything that is contrary to the spirit of Jesus Christ. That's what the lust of the flesh would look like. Anything that's contrary to the spirit of Jesus Christ. Anything that is self-centric. Anything that would be that which I fall in love with that is about myself. And he says, be careful. Be careful that we don't find ourselves, maybe after walking with the Lord for years, that we don't get drawn back into loving these things. The love of beauty without the corresponding love of righteousness. That's how I would define the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. And that's the very next thing, the lust of the eye. That's a love for things that are beautiful without a corresponding marriage to loving righteousness. What do I mean by that? All of us are created to love things that are beautiful. We see things that are beautiful and we want them. We see it in the very original sin story. Going back to Genesis chapter 3, in the original sin story, when Adam and Eve fell away and sinned and ushered sin into this world, it says this: when the woman, speaking of Eve, saw that the tree was good for food, and that was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God had told Adam and Eve, you can eat of all of the fruit of this garden. Everything's provided for you. All of the fruit, everything, it's all taken care of. Just don't eat of this one fruit, of this one tree. And in so doing, he gave man a choice. For without the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, man would have been robotic in his love for God. There would have been no choice. And love demands a choice. We have to choose. And so he puts that tree in the garden, says, don't eat of that. But when Eve sees it, she sees, wow, the tree is good for food. And it's pleasant to the eyes. And a tree to be desired to make one wise. And so she took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. It was good for food. It was pleasant to the eyes. And in taking of it, it would make one wise. And she had these desires to be wise and to eat of this fruit, and it would be good because she saw it and it was beautiful. And these three things, they all concern the appeal of beauty. She saw it and wanted it. But as the record shows, because there was not within her this same love for righteousness, what she did with that beauty ultimately got her and Adam thrown out of the garden. What she did when she saw that beauty without having a love for righteousness ended up doing what ought not have been done with that which was beautiful. The tree was beautiful. It did have these qualities. She was attracted to it. She wanted it. It was something beautiful in her eyes, and the lust of the eye drew her in, and yet without that counterbalance of wanting righteousness more, loving righteousness more, wanting to please God more. Well, the end result was total destruction. And the love of beauty is a constant temptation for the believer and the unbeliever. It's a constant temptation for humanity. Mankind desires things that are beautiful. Every man does. I don't think I've ever met a person that desires ugly things. Every person wants that which is better, that which is more beautiful. It's a part of our nature. God made us that way. We desire beautiful things because God creates beautiful things. And he made us in his image. And so we have these desires. We see things and we're like, that is beautiful. God created beauty. His art is the most beautiful art ever. And so he created that beauty. He has a desire for that beauty. You and I have a desire for beauty. But if we don't have a desire to love God and a desire to love righteousness, then what we do with that beauty will become perverted. And that's what happened in the garden. And the lust of the eyes in this context is used in a broad and negative sense. And John is not saying don't love or don't desire beautiful things. That's what he's not saying that. He's not saying you shouldn't desire beautiful things. All of us already do. John is saying that we should desire righteousness. We should desire holiness. We should desire Christ in tandem with the beauty that we see. For if we do not, then those beautiful things will be abused, and those will lead us ultimately to destruction. And this all looks different for each one of us. James, the brother of Jesus, says, every man is enticed by his own lust. And when that lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. And so every man is enticed in a different way. All of mankind, it is enticed by different beautiful things. And what may be beautiful for one person will not be beautiful for another. All of us have our different ways of looking at beauty. And so therefore, beauty really is in the eye of the beholder. And so we're all tempted in different ways. We all see beautiful things. Case in point, this all looks different for each one of us. Men generally desire beautiful women. Case in point. And this is a very natural part of the DNA of mankind. A man will see a beautiful woman and there's an attraction. And that'll vary based on the man. But this should always be tempered with righteousness. What I do with what I see must be tempered with, I want to do the right thing. I want to act correctly. I want to walk righteously. I desire to honor God with the beauty that I see. And there's a way to appreciate beauty without destroying it. And without, you know, going off the cliff. And if there's no balance to the beautiful things that we see, then oftentimes we'll destroy that beauty. And if I have no purity and holiness and righteousness to temper that which I desire, that which I see as beautiful, there is always a world of destruction. Always. It always ends up in destruction. Sin always kills. To change that analogy to a more broader sense, This same type of attraction and beauty can be applied in a variety of different ways. You can look at it as far as sexuality is concerned, but you can also look at it with just, you know, abstract things such as cars or fill in the blank, you know, cars or trucks or guns or homes. Or properties, or clothing, or jewelry, or fill in the blank. I mean, the list could go on and on. And nothing is wrong with those things in and of themselves. They can be really beautiful things. I met a brother this morning that we were talking briefly, and he, since he was a young man, he's had a Corvette. I'm like, that is really cool. And he was telling me that somebody was asking him, why do you have a Corvette after all these years? And he goes, I like to go fast, you know? And I'm like, yeah, okay, I get that. And that's probably a beautiful thing. And nothing wrong with any of that. You know, we have homes. We have clothing. We have jewelry. I don't wear jewelry, but, you know, we have things. And nothing is wrong with those things. But John is saying, be careful that we don't love those things more than righteousness. Because if we do, and we don't have a love for righteousness that transcends the things that we see that are beautiful, whatever they might be, then we'll abuse those things and they will destroy us. Because lust is like a fire. And the more that we feed it, the hotter it burns. Lust is like a fire. The more we feed it, the hotter it burns. And so John, the Apostle John, is warning us, be careful that we don't live in a world of lust. And that's not just a sexual lust. It's a lust for anything that transcends a love for Christ. For if we do not have that balance, lust will take root in our life, and every man is enticed and drawn away by his own lust. And lust, when it is conceived, it brings forth sin. And when sin is finished, it brings forth death. And John is warning, saying, don't love the worldly system. Thirdly, the pride of life. The pride of life. The pride of life is rejoicing in our own superiority. Rejoicing in our superior circumstances. Rejoicing in our superior way of living. The pride of life is not simply arrogant, boastful attitudes. It's not simply desiring to be heard constantly and being right about everything. The pride of life is just a mindset of superiority overall. It's, I believe, captured in our modern day culture in this motion. You know, lips kind of puckered out. Guys are even doing this now. Kind of, you know, check me out, man, you know, taking that posting that selfie and to show others how great I am, and maybe they will have envy and learn to behave like me. You know, that's kind of the mindset that can be. And the pride of life is entirely behavior-based and envy-driven. You want to be like me. You want to change your thing to be like me. You want to dress like me. You want to talk like me because, well, I'm superior. Jesus puts it this way in Luke chapter 18. He really gives us an incredible snapshot of what this pride of life looks like. In Luke chapter 18, verse 10, he says this: two men went to the temple to pray. And one was a Pharisee, he was a pastor. He was a church leader at the time. One was a Pharisee, and the other was a despised tax collector. And the Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer: I thank you, God, that I'm not a sinner like Brock. I mean, like everyone else. For I don't cheat, I don't sin, I don't commit adultery, and I'm certainly not like that tax collector. Apparently, there was a tax collector within his vision, and he probably is pointing over there while he's talking to God. I'm glad I'm not like that guy. I fast twice a week, and I give you a tenth of my income. But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, "Oh God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner." And I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. See, the tax collector, he understood his need for forgiveness. He was not comparing himself with others. He understood that he had violated the holiness of God, of which all of us have. He realized that he did not live up to the righteous standards of God, as none of us have. And he just, on his knees, beat his chest and before God said, I just am in desperate need of forgiveness. Lord, show me mercy. And the religious leader, on the other hand, that was not his posture. He needed nothing but himself. He needed nothing but his own superiority. And Jesus contrasts the two in the story. And he says, this is the man that's justified. And Christ would go to the cross, and he would give his life. And anyone who cries out like this publican or this tax collector and just says, Lord, I need forgiveness, that man is justified, made just as if he'd never sinned. No matter who we are, no matter where we've been, no matter what we've done. And I have been plowing through these scriptures and reading through 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Jude, and Revelation on a regular basis for months now. And I've shared with you guys how when I share these things, the Lord in his grace forces this stuff to go through my own heart. And I'm thankful for that, but at the same time, I wish I didn't have to work this stuff out all the time, in my flesh anyway. And I am thoroughly convinced that the reason that God has called me to the work of the ministry and the preaching and teaching of God's word is because I need to hear it more than most. So he's like, Jim, I want you to preach, and I not only want you to be reading my word, but every time you teach it, it's got to go through, you got to hear it more than most people because you're just a little dull, and that's why I've called you. And so I'm working this stuff through. And something happens when you've been walking with the Lord for a long time. You read these scriptures. Yeah, I know. The lust of the eye, lust fresh, pride of life. I get it. I've studied this. I've done all my word studies. I know it in the original language. I've broke it all down. I've listened to what everybody else has to say about it. I've read it in the context, backwards, sideways, forwards. I've memorized it. I got it. And then the Lord, in his grace, says, no, Jim, not really. And this last week, actually in the last couple of weeks, the Lord's really impressed on me that, no, I'm not even close to have this. Because the Lord really spoke to me, Jim, if you love the things of this world, it's going to be shown by the most important thing to you, or one of the most important things in your life. And that is, Jim, how do you spend your money? Well, Lord, I give. I mean, I want to be called a generous man. Matter of fact, when Maureen and I were married almost 30 years ago now, we decided from the very beginning that was just going to be a part of our life, and we wanted to grow in that every year. Because what we see in your word is a generous person is a happy person. A generous person is out of themselves. And your word says that life begins when I die. And if I want to have life, I need to give up my life. And so we determined right out of the gate as a couple, that's going to be a part of our life from the very beginning. And we're going to start with the Old Testament principle of tithing or 10%, even though we know we're not under that. But we want to grow from there. That's like our starting point. But we want to be givers. And we want to live in that faith because your word says that we can never outgive you. And if I believe that, then I will be very generous because I know that you will always be Jehovah Jireh. You will be my provider. And Jesus, you taught me by your word that wherever my treasure is, that's where my heart's going to be. And what I have found is I have this incredible love for Jesus and his church, specifically us, Mountain Church. Matter of fact, I came in this morning and it was before anybody was out in the lobby area there. And as I walked through, I was like, oh, I love this place. I love these people. I'm so glad to be here. And I hope that's always the case. And I believe that part of that is because, man, this is where my investment is, my life investment. But the Lord checked me on that and said, yeah, Jim, you do that, but be careful that you don't just give out of legalism or that you don't just give out of, well, you're giving more than you once, or, you know, percentage-wise than what you once did. Keep giving. Keep trusting me. And the Lord really convicted me of, you know what? I think that perhaps I've been drawn back into a love of the world a bit. And that's demonstrated in how I spend my money. And so, Lord, forgive me. I want to give more. I want to be more generous. And so my prayer has been, Lord, I love you and I love your people. And I want to invest my money in you and your people, for this is where I want my heart to remain. For a passion for Jesus and a passion for the kingdom. And so I want to be more generous. And if I've lost a passion for your people, and I've lost a passion for the lost, and I've lost a passion for the kingdom of God, and I've lost a passion, the reason is because, well, maybe my treasure isn't there anymore. Because Jesus said that where my treasure is where my heart is going to be. And so I want to share with you guys, I have a little family meeting once again. We did this a couple of weeks ago. So if you're visiting, great time to check Facebook or check your emails or go get a cup of coffee or whatever. But if Mountain Church is your home, I just want to share with you from my heart. Mountain Church has been a month-to-month ministry for 14 years now. And God has always graciously and incredibly, miraculously provided. And that's by design. We don't have a lot of assets. We have a couple of old vans and a guitar and some older computers. We don't have assets, and that's by design over the years. And my heart has always been, as well as the heart of the elders over the years, has always been, Lord, we want to walk by faith. And that means that whatever comes in goes out. And sometimes we have a little abundance at the end of the month, but immediately that goes back out in helping others. But we want to be good witnesses for Christ in our community. So that means that we pay our bills on time, and we have very minimal bills. In other words, we've made no commitment to month-to-month giving to anything else. We pay for our lease so that we have this building, and I'm so thankful for this, that we've got this building downtown. And we've been leasing it now for 13 years. And it's been beautiful and awesome and wonderful. And it's been fair. And we're not overpaying for it, but we're not underpaying for it. And it's just a fair lease. And every 5 years we've renewed that lease. But it's, you know, progressively gotten more expensive as the years go on. And that's, you know, part of life. And so I think we're right around $20,000 a month right now just for the lease. And so the Lord brings that in. And so we take those resources and we pay that bill, and we've paid it every time on time for 13 years. And then we have, after that, it's broken into kind of two halves of the month. The next half of the month is, okay, Lord, we're trusting that you're going to provide so that we can make the payroll for the staff. And so we take whatever comes in and we make that. And then at the end of the month, if we have anything left, it's always been, we're not going to save that. We're going to use that for the kingdom. Whatever that is, we're going to use it for the kingdom, because we know that there's needs, and those needs are immediate. Those needs are now. And you're our savings plan, Lord, so we're going to trust you, and that's how we're going to function. And that's what we've chosen to do. Some would say, man, that's not a really good business model. We're not a business. We're a church. Dave Ramsey would not appreciate that style of financial, you know, responsibility, but I see it in God's word. And so we take those resources and we support, when we can, every month, different ministries that are Jesus ministries in our community. We do outdoor evangelistic outdoor, you know, outreaches in our community. And we do we use our resources to lift Jesus up in our community, and all of the maintenance and all the repairs and upgrades that are necessary to this old building, and the list goes on and on, helping those that are in need, helping the widows, helping the single moms among us that can't make their electric payments, and it's winter time and it's cold in their homes. We'll make those payments. We're constantly in that mode of giving because of our generosity. And right now, presently, Mountain Church is in a financial deficit. And God is calling me, and he's calling us as his people to live generously, to give generously. And if all of us choose to say, I'm going to give generously out of what I have, then Mountain Church will thrive. I've seen it. And God's at work. God is doing something in Mountain Church, our family, us right here. He's doing something in our hearts through this present crisis. He always is. Whenever there's a crisis, I get excited. Like, oh, all right on. God's doing something. I would have never, you know, I didn't invite the crisis. I didn't pray for the crisis. But when the crisis happens, I'm like, awesome. Lord, I know you're at work. You're doing something, and you're maturing me, and you're maturing us, and that's a good thing. And so I welcome the crisis. And if we choose, you and I, all of us, 100% of us, all of us that call Mountain Church our home, if we choose to say, I'm going to be generous, Lord. I'm going to trust you with my finances. I'm not going to love the world system. I'm going to totally be about the kingdom of God. And I choose to give. If we choose, all of us, to give generously, then our church, Mountain Church, your church, will thrive. If we don't, it won't. If we do, it will. And presently, Mountain Church is not thriving at all. We may be looking to find another facility to meet in. Not because if all of us gave, we couldn't afford it, but because we don't have the money presently. We don't have the money. Literally, we just don't have the money. And we're not getting a loan. I believe that that's unbiblical. I don't think we should get loans to go into debt to, you know, thrive as a church. And so that could be what the Lord is doing. Maybe the Lord is calling us to, you know, downsize and get a storefront and just have a smaller, I don't know. I don't know what he's doing. I have no idea. But I do know I'm excited about whatever it is. And I know that the Lord's going to bring us to exactly where he wants us to be. And oftentimes he'll use crisis like this to move us and shake us and form us. And that's good. That's healthy. And I think that I would be an irresponsible pastor if I didn't share these things with you guys. I would be totally irresponsible to, you know, wait and wait and wait, and then all of a sudden show up one day and say, by the way, I'm out of here, or whatever, you know, or by the way, we're shutting the doors, or by the way, we're moving because we couldn't, or whatever, you know. We've looked at the possibility of purchasing this building. And by the way, that has not even been a possibility for 12 years. It hasn't been for sale. This year, one of the owners has been beginning to entertain the idea of possibly selling the building to us, which is great. But we looked into commercial loans and all of that. And because we give our money away all the time, we don't have any assets, nobody will give us a loan. But we could get, you know, if we had a $300,000 or $400,000 down payment and bought the building, our lease would at least be cut in half. And that would be amazing to think about. Wow, you know, what amazing things we could do with an extra $10,000 every month. What kingdom work could we do? I mean, how impactful we could be in our community. So we've looked at that. We've looked at downsizing the staff. They're hearing about that first right now. But we're running on fumes as a staff already. And we can't possibly pay the staff any less. And I mean, Maureen and I, we look around at the staff that God has put in Mountain Church and we're like, there's not one person on staff that doesn't absolutely carry their load and more. And there's not one person on staff as we look at it that we could do without. I don't know how, I mean, we're lean. I mean, it's a lean, lean staff. And so we can't possibly pay them any less. We already don't have any insurance to pay the staff. We had to do away with the insurance benefits several years ago because we simply just don't have the money. So all the staff, they're on their own to pay for their own insurance. And the financial state of Mountain Church is dire right now. And it's not for a lack of pinching every penny. It's not for a lack of being frugal. It's not for a lack of making, you know, wise financial decisions. Even all the warriors, they pay a tuition, and that tuition covers any of the outings that we do with the warriors, and we're actually under budget in that for this year. And we have had to do less outdoor services just because we simply don't have the money. And I understand that there are many that you know, have to stretch every dollar to make every penny count, and I get that. I understand that. And God doesn't call us to, you know, give and then starve to death. He's not saying that at all. God is just saying if 100% of us gave, if 100% of us chose to give of what we did have, then we would thrive. So perhaps there's many that can give, and all of us should give, and maybe some of, I don't know, I have no idea what your financial status is. Maybe some of you can finance the building, and we can purchase the building. Maybe some of you are like, man, I could just totally write a check for the down payment right now. I could just buy the building right now. You know, I don't know. But I do know this, is we're all in this thing together. And if we don't all give of what we have, we just won't thrive. And I love you guys, and this is why I tell you this. This is why I don't just, you know, keep this to myself. Because we're a family. We're all in this thing together. And it's only fair that you understand, wow, this is where we're at. This isn't where Jim's at. This isn't where the staff's at. This isn't where Mountain Church is at. This is where we're at. We are Mountain Church. And I can't carry this alone. I can't. Maureen and I can't carry this alone. We need your help. I need your help. And I'm asking you to share this load with me. I'm asking you to burden this load with me and say, okay, yeah, I can help. I can give. I can serve. I can die. I can love the church. I can do that. I'll do my part, whatever my part is. I need you right now, personally, and we need you together as a family to say, yeah, I'm going to carry this load. And so I need you, and I would ask you to pray about what the Lord would have you give, not just in this crisis, but regularly, because this is your church. It's not my church. It's not the staff's church. It's not a building. This is our church. It's God's church, but we're his people. And your church needs you to be a generous giver. And it's biblical, so I can say these things with great confidence, and I can say it with the authority of God's word, and I can say it without any embarrassment. I can say it without feeling like, you know, I'm begging or anything like that. I'm not. This is biblical. It's a mark of our own maturity. It's an act of worship. And without all of us getting on board and being generous givers, mountain just simply will not thrive. But having said all of that, I thoroughly 100% believe with all of my heart that this is a season that God is bringing us to and through. It's just a season. He's bringing us to it, and he will bring us through it. And he's going to bring us to the other side of this and reveal the purpose. Because I believe in my heart that God does desire for us to have this building and for our overhead to become nothing at some point. I believe that. And I believed that for years, and I didn't know when it was going to happen, and I still have no idea. It doesn't look like it's going to happen, but I believe God wants us in that position so that we can even be a more effective city of refuge in our community. I believe God wants that. And that is totally in our hands, because I believe that the resources are available among us. It's just a matter of, well, let's be generous. And so what we're going to do right now is we're going to take a few minutes. We're going to have communion together, and we're going to pray. And as we pray, we're going to have communion together. So I'll open up the tables. Everybody will receive the elements of communion, hang on to them, and then we'll have communion together as a family. But during that time, just be praying and saying, Lord, search my heart. And I desire, Lord, that you would speak to me on what I am to give as a part of my family, as a part of my church on a regular basis, or maybe a lump sum or whatever. I don't know. But just say, Lord, how would you have me love in this way? And the giving boxes are available down in front and in the back. And, you know, maybe the Lord will put it on your heart to go home and go online and say, I'm going to start giving regularly. And I'm going to go onto the website, and I'm going to go to the giving page, and I'm going to choose to put in my account number there, and I'm going to choose to every month I'm going to give this amount, or every 2 weeks. That's what Marina and I do, and we've upped that. We've chosen to say, you know what, Lord, I want my heart to be even more invested in the kingdom. And that's a way to give. And at the same time, to just be thankful that God has allowed us this great privilege of worshiping him and knowing him and serving him and loving one another and just being a part of an incredible church. And I couldn't be more grateful. And as a pastor, and I know I've said this many times, and I'll continue to lie to you, but I would never want to pastor any other church than Mountain Church. And I'm just kidding about lying about that. I love Mountain Church. And I think it's fair that we're all informed on kind of where we're at, and I do believe that this is a season he's brought us to, and it's a season that he's going to bring us through. In Jesus' name, let's pray together. Father, we just give you praise. We're so thankful, Lord, for how you are our sustainer. You're our great provider. You take care of us on every level, always have, always will. And a lot of times, Lord, you allow us to go through some real stretching times, some times of discipline, some times of correction, because you love us so much. And Lord, you want to put us on the right trajectory. And so, Lord, we just desire, Lord, to hear your voice as we come to your table and give thanks for your body and your blood that was given for us. We realize that you've given everything to us. Lord, we desire to be generous givers too. And so, Lord, as you speak, your people, we listen and we respond. And we're grateful and we're thankful for your forgiveness. We're thankful for your amazing grace. So as we worship you now, Lord, be honored, be blessed. As we come to your table, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. The tables are open for giving. The tables are open for receiving the elements of communion. And then we'll all have communion together in just a moment.
There his love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again, victorious. With faithfulness none can deny, through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me.
You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. Is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. 'Cause you are stronger, you are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. I look to the cross, I cling. Of its suffering, I do drink. Of its work, I do sing. For on it, my Savior, both bruised and crushed, showed that God is love and God is just. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
priceless gift, undeserved life. Have I been given through Christ crucified? You called me out of death. You called me into life. I was under your wrath. Now through the cross I'm reconciled. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
And Lord, it's an honor to surrender, totally an honor. To be able to just surrender our life and say, Lord, we are yours. We've been purchased at a great price. And we remember that this morning. We remember, Lord, that it's by your body being broken, Lord, that we have been healed, that we have been restored into right relationship with you. The chain of sin, the bondage, Lord, it's been broken. And we're no longer a slave to the enemy. We're no longer a slave to sin and our flesh. But Lord, we get to willfully surrender our life to a great King, the King of Kings. And it's all because of what you've done for us, Lord. So we just give you praise this morning. We thank you for loving us and demonstrating that love. Even while we were yet sinners, you died for us, Lord. And so we take this bread and we eat it, Lord, in remembrance of you, in Jesus' name. Let's take the bread together. Thank you, Lord. And at that Last Supper, in the same manner, Lord, you took that cup and you drank with your disciples and you told them, this is the new covenant, the new testament in my blood. No longer trying to achieve righteousness by the works of the law, no longer under the sacrificial system of old that was just a shadow, that was insufficient and incomplete and perpetual, of the transferring of sin onto some animal that would be sacrificed on our behalf. That was just a shadow of that which was perfect that would come, and that was you, Lord. You, the perfect Lamb of God, that you would shed your blood once and for all. It's finished. It's over. Our sins are totally forgiven, and we can boldly come into your throne room of grace anytime, anywhere, with our heads held high, knowing that we are adopted as your own, that you call us sons and daughters, and it's all because of the blood of Christ. Our forgiveness has been perfectly, eternally purchased by the blood of Christ. And so we celebrate you and we thank you and we remember you as we take this cup together this morning in Jesus' name. Let's take the cup. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for cleansing us. Thank you for redeeming our broken lives. Thank you for justifying us, making us just as if I'd never sinned. Thank you for adopting us as your own, calling us your children. We just praise you and love you and bless you and desire, Lord, that you would just fill us with your spirit, even now, Lord, as we sing out praise to you. as we close our time together as your family, Lord, just shouting out praise and giving you honor, Lord, you be blessed. You be lifted up, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing this final song.
Sunrise, the colors of the morning are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. I look up to the sky and say, you're beautiful.
Maturing and growing and becoming more and more Christ-like in our generosity and in our mercy toward one another and our love for one another. That's what God's doing. He's shaping us. He's changing us. And we need it. I need it. And if nobody else, certainly me. I'm so thankful that God is at work and in our church and through His Word and by His Spirit. So God bless you guys. Have an awesome, awesome week. And yeah, just give lots of money and everything's fine. That'll work out great. So God bless you guys. Hey, thanks for joining us today online and taking in the Word with us and worshiping with us. My name is Pastor Jim here at Mountain Church. And I know you were totally blessed by the Word, but I'd love to have the opportunity to meet you. And so if you can make it down to any of our weekend services, we'd love to pray with you, love to get to know you and help you get connected. So if you need more information, check out mtnchurch.tv, and most of our information is posted there.
God bless you guys, and I look forward to seeing you soon.